Thank you very much. As we are celebrating here in the land of the rising sun, this is the second round of the Formula Drift Championship we've had here in Japan. It is the exclamation point on the season. Ryan, we're about to meet our top 16 drivers, so let's introduce you to our top 16 drivers. Starting off with our number one qualifier. We're working our way left to right. He had a really strong showing. If you were watching earlier or yesterday in qualifying and in top 32, he had an easy fast pass into the top 16. But he is a force to be reckoned with, and he is definitely one to watch as we are going to get our camera in the sky and see if we can get an up-close shot. But as you can see, left to right, our top 16 drivers, a wide variety of vehicles out here on track. So let's introduce you to our drivers. Our first battle, starting left to right, our number one qualifier in the Bold World R34 Skyline, it's Tsutomu Fujio. He's going to be going against our number 16 qualifier. He is in the S14. He's going against Junji Yamamoto. There's Junji Yamamoto there. The Zeke S14 Sylvia, those two gentlemen are going head to head. Moving on down the line, our number 8 qualifier in the Goodyear Mark X. He is simply known as Kuniaki Takahashi. Moving on down the line, qualifying 24th. He's in car number 50 in the Gretti Toyo GTR. It is Masato Kawabata. Our next battle on deck, car number 13, qualifying 20th in the Goodyear S15. It's Kunihiko Teramachi. He's going against Masaka Kasahara, who qualified 29th. Our next battle, you know him and you love him across the globe. He qualified 5th, our 2013 Asia champion in the Achilles Raider Sunoco Pro Drive Mark II. He is Daigo the Ninja Saito. He will be going against the FD RX7 wrapped with exiting R Magic. It's Yukio Matsui, who qualified 12th. Qualifying 2nd, car number 4 in the D-Max S15, Masashi Yokoi. Our last Thai driver that fought the fight, knocking all the other ones out. He qualified 15th. He's in the Westlake Alteza. He's simply known as S. Our next battle, qualifying 7th in the Magic FDRX7. It's Manabu Fujinaka. Manabu Fujinaka will be going against our number 10 qualifier in the AQM S14. It's Yoshiaki Owaki. Our next battle has another D-Max S15, this one running the TKL sponsorship, qualifying 3rd, Akira Harajima. He's going against originally from Scotland, now residing here in Japan, operating power vehicles out of Ebisu Circuit, it's Andrew Gray. And officially, our 2014 Formula Drift Asia Champion, 2nd in the Formula Drift Domestic Championship in the RSR V8. GT86, it's the Norwegian Hammer, Fredrik Osbo. Fredrik Osbo will be going and doing battle against our final competitor, qualifying 11th in the Goodyear Mark II, Tamakazu Hirota. Those are your top 16 drivers here at the first ever Formula Drift Japan here at Okayama International Circuit. I'm Jared Deanda, Ryan Sage. We have some great drivers, good diverse vehicles. It should be a great one. So Ryan, you know, Fredrik Osbo wraps up the championship, you know, with Suinaga getting knocked out early.
Yeah, I mean, obviously for Osbo, that's one more championship trophy to put up there. The guy obviously has had a celebrated history in Europe, making his way over to the U.S., 2nd in points in the U.S. championship, and now closing his first chapter in his first ever Formula Drift Asia championship. Congratulations to him and the whole RSR team for putting together a good program and going all the way from Thailand, Japan, twice, Australia. It's been a long road.
Yeah, when they travel big too. I mean, they have quite a big team. They have you know, crew coming from the States, they have crew coming from Japan, they have, you know, obviously Fredrik Osbo coming from Norway, as we see Daigo Saito getting settled there. Now again, Daigo Saito debuting his new car that will be at Formula Drift next year. As I was taking a look there at Hirota's car, or Kuni's car. Saw the Goodyear on the side. You know, seeing all the chatter online about all the 2Js, all the variety of vehicles, we'll be back. We're going to see them do a battle here in just a few moments. When we come back, we're going to see our first battle in Top 16. All right, well, Ryan, as
the brightness called brilliant, blinding and vivid, bounty. Love driving. Advan. Yokohama. Your tire.
The Osaka Auto Messe is a motor show based around the theme of customizing. Be sure to come and find your own special customization that meets your desires at the Osaka Auto Messe.
I know when I toss my car into a turn at over 100 miles per hour, it's going to hold it. If you don't have confidence in your tires, you have nothing.
Love driving. Advan. Yokohama, your tire. The brightness called brilliant, blinding and vivid. Valenti.
The sun is out. There are clouds still looming. As we took a short break, it got pretty dark and gray, but now we are seeing the sun kind of pop out behind the clouds and bless us with some little bit of warm weather, some warmth in what has been a brisk, cold day, windy. But the fans are still out here, and you know, by comparison to Fuji, we're seeing more fans. As you know, obviously there's been other drifting sanction bodies that have been here in Japan. We've seen it grow, we've seen it evolve. But you know, Formula Drift really making a name for itself, Ryan, internationally, and I think that's why, you know, those that are just fans of drifting, they know that Formula Drift is just setting precedence for years to come.
Yeah, no doubt about it. I mean, it's been 11 years since sports started in the U.S. and to come back to Japan. We mentioned this when we were in Fuji, but really has come full circle. You know, I can actually remember partner Jim coming to Japan to first talk with D1 about doing an event for them in the winter fall of 2003, and since that time, it's been, you know, basically 100% drifting life up until now. And so to be hanging out in Okayama and sitting next to you and doing commentating, watching some of the best drifters do their thing under the Formula D brand, it's pretty exciting.
Yeah, I'm sure it's a proud moment. It's like a child being born, and you know, it is pretty rad to be part of the drifting DNA and the growth of it. You know, even during the halftime break, talking to Robin Ishida, who you know, he's seen a lot of different drifting sanction bodies. He's seen different, you know, sanction bodies, people, drivers, and I think Robbie is really you know, campaign himself as a Formula Drift driver. So he's heard all sides. So he was somebody that I was really happy to get a conversation with him, and Kevin Wells and I talked about just different nuances of Japanese culture and respect and humility and where Formula Drift fits in as a brand. And I think it's nowhere but up, you know, because you're seeing the right drivers show up, and we know there's more out there, and you said it, D1 is a sanctioned body that you helped bring to the States, and then you saw the future of bringing Formula Drift to, you know, full circle, and here we are, literally full circle as it's back here in Japan under the Formula Drift brand. So thank you for joining us. If you're online, we are live. We are on Daily Motion. Let everybody know on social media that you are here. Hashtag FDJapan, FormulaD.com/live. Let everybody know, log in. Let's blow up the internet as a local time back home, about 8:30 or so. And then, depending on where you're at, 8:30 Pacific Standard Time. So, yeah. Thank you so much for joining us. Hashtag FDJapan. And on Instagram and Twitter, Ryan and myself will be checking it throughout today's festivities. I've been giving some shout-outs, and we've been a little casual, Ryan, just having some fun conversations and making jokes about deers and wolves and Bambis and carnage, and
yeah,
just having some fun.
Well, it's pretty fun. I mean, for people that don't come to the events in the U.S. and they only hear us through the live stream, they may or may not realize that it's the same commentating going out to live as well. Well, this is an exception to that, where we're just going out to live stream. And it definitely has a different feel to it, you know. When your voice is being audibly heard over a PA, I think it comes with a different vibe, whereas this is really, you know, just pure commentating, hanging out, having a good time, calling it like you see it, and watching the show and enjoying it just as much as the people at home are.
Yeah, it's, you know, I know you watch a lot of surfing, and, you know, I watch some other live streams to just see what other people do, and it's definitely fun to just kind of kick back and see what's going on. All right, we got Mario Johnston logging in here. Right on, man. And yeah, Mad Mike, he's back here watching again. Mad Mike, cheer, bro. Hiroshima Drift Screamer. Nice, well played. I'm Beach Steez, bro. John Pinguini is logging in, watching. And we're going to put a bow on this and give out some trophies here. And so we're going to whittle it down. You can see our hot pit area. So, Ryan, we're getting word that about 8 minutes away from start as the hot pit area, you could see that Fujio back there warming up his tires in that bold World Skyline R34. Ryan, talking about next year, we'll talk about it again because some people are tuning in just now. Next year is the announcement of the World Championship, or the debut of it, I should say, as the World Championship will include a round in Japan, a round in Canada, and then you put it out there, China.
Yeah, it's been a year in the making. We announced it's actually last SEMA, not this last SEMA, a couple of weeks ago,
right,
a month or so ago, but last year. And we spent this entire year kind of prepping for it, you know, what events are going to be World Championship events, who the partners are going to be, what's the structure going to be like. And now that's basically all set, and it's just about planning and executing at this point. So,
And you might want to explain, because even for some of the drivers inquiring about it, it's not, you don't have to exactly go to Japan, go to Canada, go to China. If you do either Canada or Japan, and then which rounds of the stateside rounds do you need to do? All of them, or because is it a domestic championship and a world championship?
The easiest way to explain it is you must do one non-domestic round to qualify for world championship points.
Okay.
So if you're an international driver or a domestic driver, you've got to look at the three non-domestic rounds and pick from one of those. Now, for 100% of the people, it's going to be Japan or Montreal, because the last round is actually a round that you have to qualify for. So if you choose Japan and you're doing the events in the U.S., that'll be your qualification round. If you choose Montreal, that'll be your qualification round. And then what will happen is you will be adding your points from those international rounds, or the international round if you only do a singular one, pairing them with the domestic points that you've received, and it becomes a cumulative points total. So by the time we get to August, which is we have a date cutoff, for the World Championship. If you are a top eight driver for points, or if you have won an event, you will qualify, and we will pay for you to go to the final round in China. So the amount of drivers that could actually end up going to China could anywhere between 8 and 16, but at least 8, and they'll be competing against other drivers that want to come and compete in that event. So,
all right, cool. Right on. You got a shot of us here up in the tower, Dai Yoshihara, Steve Choi. But, yeah, it's we are live here, and so, Ryan, you're saying that mathematically, if you do Japan, you do Canada, you do all seven rounds, nine rounds, you have a better shot. If you know, it's, so it's a cumulative. I mean, you want to do them all. Correct?
Those that do more rounds obviously are going to add more to their point total. But if you miss a round and you do very well in the domestic series, you might find that you'll definitely be in contention. Okay. But it will be a cumulative points total at the end of the year for as many events that each participant decided to participate in.
Okay, got it. Cool. Yeah, I mean that's some good clarification on, because we get a lot of fans tuning in and a lot of drivers tuning in. Let me know who's watching out there, who's a current, past, present, or future formative competitor, right? Yep, there you go, Mario Johnston. There you go, buddy. All right, here we go. Our first battle of the top 16. This is Tsutomu Fujio going against Junji Yamamoto. Oh, Yamamoto goes way off as Fujio in that Bold World Skyline continues once again to rain smoke and rain terror in his R34 Skyline through the guillotine, hitting that outside clipping zone. And then there is one final front clip. Boom goes the dynamite for Fujio and his Bold World R34 Skyline. Ryan, quick work for Fujio as he makes his way back to the start. Let's take hopefully a look at it again as Junji quickly went off course and giving the advantage to Fujio.
Yeah, big advantage right here for Fujio. You can see coming down that front straight. Nice job on initiation, and right out of the gate, Yamamoto gets out of whack. You can see right here, he comes through the smoke cloud, is not able to hang on to the angle right here. The back end shoots out. He goes off course. He'll be sitting on a zero for run number one, but Fujio at a big advantage as now he'll chase down Yamamoto.
All right, so there's Fujio. As now Junji will be leading. Again, let everybody know that you're watching hashtag FDJAPAN, not just the simple JPN. Taking a look, we've got quite a few photos up there, 1,000 photos right now, one as the spelled out version, but let's take a look at JPN. Seeing just 122 posts over there, but on the JPAN, it's quite a good showing. So, here we go. Junji Yamamoto will be leading, as Fujio will be giving chase with that advantage.
Whoa,
wow, kind of getting a little loose there. As Fujio drops into formation, coming into view of the judges with their naked eye. Now, Fujio giving him a bit of distance, which could be a good strategy there, as you're seeing a lot of wavering from Junji. Whoa, coming to the guillotine. And through the keyhole he goes. Fujio, I assume, is going to have the victory here.
Well, here we go, Jared, taking a look at the replay here. Fujio obviously going to be moving on into the Great 8 with that performance after the zero in the first run by Yamamoto. Getting kind of slippery out there. You can see Fujio kind of anticipating the initiation here. He drops into formation as Yamamoto tries to shoot to the outside. You can see the front wheels almost coming back to neutral for Yamamoto. Seeming like he's struggling with the car a little bit. He is able to get to that outside zone, but you can see Fujio, a lot of grip right there, able to get right on the backside bumpers. They head to outer zone number two. And right here, another big mistake for Yamamoto, bringing it all the way around, stops drifting, then gets back into drift. Fujio backs off a little bit, plays it nice and conservative. He knows he's got it wrapped up at this point, so Fujio will be moving on to the Great 8.
All right, well, there it is. And, man, look at that, just door-to-door. Just a really solid driver. Bless you, Ryan. Matt Spederbo watching from Canada, the Great White North, as he's cheering on his fellow four-door competitors. All right, so Fujio unanimously gets the victory and advances on to the Great Eight. So unfortunately, Ken Gushi making the jump across the pond in his Greddy Scion FRS does not make it into the top 16, but he will be cheering on his Greddy Trust Racing GTR R35 teammate, that is Masato Kawabata. Now Kawabata will be going against Kuniaki Takahashi, excuse me, as he's simply known as Kuni. This should be a really good battle, Ryan. These guys have done battle in D1 before, and you know what, I'm looking forward to this one. Man, strap on for this one, because it's strap in, I should say. this should be a good one. Are you all right, man? Looks like you're getting allergies kicking up.
Yeah, I think so. A little
there
bit.
There you go.
Trying to manage.
So let me get this man some Pepto-Bismol. All right, here we go. So Kuni will be leading as Kuni qualified 8th, whoa, as opposed to Kawabata's 24th. All right. All right, here we go. Kuni out front, navigating through that start chicane in that Mark X. Let's see how we go, initiating into this first corner. Wow, look at that, Kawabata right there on the door.
Oh
man, look at this, Kuni and Kawabata going door to door. Good transition, let's see if we can drop back into formation. And he does, Kawabata gets back through the guillotine. Oh, look at that, closing the door, Kuni transitions. Oh. Kawabata jumps back up. Probably the best battle we've seen today. Make some noise for Kuniaki and Kawabata.
Yeah, that was something else right there. Two top professionals doing what they do. Let's take a look at this replay here. Both drivers coming down the front straight, very close to each other on initiation. Kawabata anticipates it, dives right in. Nice job by Kuniaki right there to stay nice and high on that line. But you can see Kawabata is right next to him, door to door. Kuniaki Takahashi runs that outer line right there on that outside zone. You can see just a little bit of separation and a small mistake right there by Kawabata on that transition from the first outer zone. He dives back in, though, really applies the pressure here. But look at the lead line by Takahashi. Does a great job really putting it out there. You can see another attack right there by Kawabata in the chase position. And look at the angle right here as Takahashi sweeps through and heads up the hill with Kawabata in tow. A great run by both guys. Very few mistakes. Maybe just that one by Kawabata on the transition from outer zone one to inner clip one. But outside of that, very exciting to watch. Both drivers putting on a tremendous show.
Yeah, just you know, I'll say it again. This is probably one of my favorite tracks, if not my favorite track, man, in the world. It's really just has a really good flow to it, has that high-speed entry. Gets technical, but not too technical. I mean, the only technical attribute of it is that you got to shoot through that hole there through the course, and that just gets a little bit sketchy. But you know, the announcer's curse, we haven't seen anybody hit that wall yet. And as I say that, I kind of cringe, because usually when I say something like that, it seems to happen. So we're seeing a bunch of guys tuning in, and gals, let me know you're watching. Here we go, Kawabata out front, Kuni giving chase. All right, Kawabata in the Greddy R35 GTR. Look at Kuni trying to get camouflage in that white smoke. Dropping back a little bit, but potentially going to lunge up next to Kawabata. Great showing by Kawabata as Kuni does not get to the outside clipping zone, through the keyhole and back up the hill. Great runs regardless of the outcome of this, as Kuni was chasing down Kawabata. Ryan, let's take a look at it again.
Yeah, and right out of the gate, noticeably, what was the difference between run number one and run number two? Probably a little bit of proximity on the part of Takahashi, falling back just a little bit. Not a lot, but enough to be noticeable with the great chase run by Kawabata on the first run. You can see Kawabata right there runs that nice wide line. You can see Takahashi is right there at that point. He does fall back right here. You can see about a car length between the two competitors as Kuniaki Takashi tries to dive in right here. He's unable to close the door, and you can see Kawabata out front is running a really good line, staying consistent, and then as he comes up the hill, really threading the needle, trying to get up to that first or that last out, inside clip, just slightly wide of it. So the difference between the two runs is small, but definitely Kawabata had the proximity going for him in that run.
It just seemed a little tighter. Cooney definitely had the speed. He had the excitement, but I think Kawabata was just a little tighter. And if they go one more time, I'd have to say that they're just selfish at this point. Yeah, that's what I thought. It's unanimous. Masato Kawabata gets the win, taking out Kuniaki Takahashi, and Kawabata advances on in the Gretti GTR R35. Again, shout out to Drift FC Bucky. How we doing? As a lower class brats, we got Babu watching. Look at this, JB27TT cranking some good beers, some rogue ales, and watching. Cahill 88. We got, again, lower class brats. That STI guy, South Dakota Drift. So Yukio from Garrett Turbo by Garrett watching. So keep it coming. I am Kitty watching from SF.
Kitty.
All right, so Ryan, we're moving on to our next battle. As we got Kawabata is in. Moving on to our next battle, excuse me. Kunihiko Teramachi is against Masaka Kasahara. Struggle is real. Here we go with, again, Teramachi and Kasahara. Good initiation by the bright orange S15. Pouring on more angle. You saw that was progressive.
Oh.
But the S14 falling back of Masaki. All right, Masaki coming through. Actually goes deeper on that rear clip, but didn't really need to do that. We want to see that lead car utilized as a moving clipping point. So sloppy in the chase position is Masaki. Couldn't he go out an interesting initiation, Ryan? I want you to take a look at it again. Halfway through, kind of just burp, stepped out a little more with more angle, which looked cool, but, you know, kind of want to stay consistent.
Teramachi in the lead, Kasahara in the chase position. Here we come into initiation right here. Immediately gets on the e-brake to induce initiation is Teramachi. You can see Kasahara right there trying to chase him down, stay on that line, really maxing out the angle right here. Just right on the outside, but you can see on the inside right here, Kasahara does not anticipate the move appropriately. He has to slow down. It caused him to lose proximity. Teramachi, on the other hand, perfect on that second outer zone, mid-high line coming through the third and the guillotine, and staying maxed out on the angle as he shoots back around, transitions to this last inside clip. And at this point, Kasahara is able to close the door a little bit, but the damage had been done on the first part of the course. Looks like Teramachi will be sitting on an advantage as now he'll chase down Masaki Kasahara.
All right, so that was Justin Banner cranking some beers there at home. As Pat Gooden, yep, definitely call you later, buddy, if anything unfolds. All right, so let's alternate the order. Masaki will be now leading, who seemed to be struggling there in that chase position. All right, here we go. Masaki initiating into that first rear clipping zone. Kunihiko is right there. A little bit of wavering there by Masaki. Kunihiko falling back. Oh, Masaki going in hard. Great. Oh, first victim of the guillotine.
You called it, man.
Woo! There it is. Going in way too hard, and that just goes to show you. Oh, man. It's reminiscent of the June main crash at Long Beach earlier this year. Just not a straight panel on it and a complete yard sale. We'll make sure he's okay. Fortunately, did hit that tire. Let's take a look at it again, Ryan. Make sure he's okay.
Well, here we go. Obviously, the biggest result of that run was the crash towards the end there by Masaki Kasahara. He's taking the lead here, comes into initiation. Both drivers really close at this point. Kasahara taking a middle line right here, trying to stay wide. He's not able to get fully out there. He gets into the last part of the zone. This is where the transition comes into interclip one. A lot of speed here. big angle, but unable to get on enough throttle to slow him down for this. He hits the first wall right there, which is actually designed to shoot you off because there is no leading edge there, thankfully. And the tire wall is hit, and it looks like his car will sustain some pretty sizable damage. He will be towed off course, and this will be a win for Kunihiko Teramachi. Unfortunately for Masaki Kasahara, he's now got some repair work to do before that car gets back out on course.
All right, so as we are going to take a quick break, we have obviously a lot to clean up and swallow some pride here, but a big hit, our first victim of the keyhole, the guillotine, the gauntlet, whatever you want to call it. We are making history here at Okayama International Circuit for the final round of the Formula Drift Asia Championship. When we come back, we'll see more battles ensue and some potential more carnage.
The brightness, called brilliant, blinding and vivid, Valenti.
Love driving. Advan. Yokohama, your tire.
The Osaka Auto Messe is a motor show based around the theme of customizing. Be sure to come and find your own special customization that meets your desires at the Osaka Auto Messe.
I know when I toss my car into a turn at over 100 miles per hour, it's going to hold it. If you don't have confidence in your tires, you have nothing.
The brightness, called brilliant, blinding and vivid, Valenti.
All right, well, we are back. We're still assessing the damage, but let's make it official. And I have to assume, obviously, with the action, that is definitely... Lantaine, he crashed. Why would you say that? I'm kidding. I'm joking. There was obviously an error there as Teramachi obviously gets the victory. Lantaine's blind. See, it, you know, when he comes to Japan, he gets a little.
I knew it. Gets cross-eyed.
Little pitted out.
Yeah.
The wolves got to him. All right. So we are cleaning up the course. Things are getting back in their respective places. So, again, technology, best friend, sometimes your enemy.
Now, that's a crane. Look at that.
That, wow. Yeah, that's, that. I've never seen that at a Formula Drift U.S. event. Ryan, when are we getting one of those?
I don't know. Have Kevin build one right away.
Yeah, get on that.
Big Kev.
Get Big Kev on it. Big Kev could whittle one from a single piece of metal. Big Kev, the human match. The human thermometer.
you too.
Well, if you're just tuning in, we are live here at Okayama International Circuit. For the final round of the Formula Drift Asia Championship. Boom goes the dynamite. Prince Sean gathering the information. So car number 13, Kunihiko Teramachi gets the win. Just to clarify, Teramachi gets the win and advances on to the Great Eight. Babu, how we doing, buddy, up there in Canada? Stay warm. Guitar D Racing watching. Matt Keenan watching from... New Zealand. Sweet as, bro.
Here you go, Jared. Let's take a look at this one more time.
Yeah, it was pretty exciting.
You can see Kasahara out front coming through this first inside clip here. And as he transitions, he gets a lot of angle in the vehicle. He's carrying a lot of speed there. Gets on the throttle. You can see the smoke coming out, but he's just not able to pull away from that wall. He's probably about a foot too deep, maybe a foot or two too deep. And then he hits the wall at the angle where the wall is at. It's designed if a car makes contact with there, with that part of the course, will actually shoot them off down away, so it's not a direct hit. And then there's a tire barricade there for some extra cushioning. But unfortunately for him, even at that angle, there's no way to salvage the vehicle.
No, he was over before it began. He transitioned. He knew he needed to let it hang out because his chase run was a bit lackluster. Transitioned through and just carried too much speed. And that's a big blow. I mean, there's not the essential items on that back end as he slapped the base big time, but that back left corner is definitely damaged.
Slapping the base
big time, big time. Looks like Michael and the War Machines Drift team enjoying. Get that Aquafina bottle down there so we could down in front there. Surgeon Stein back in the mix. I am Glenn, Golden Pony Project. Mark Williams, 89, is watching from Australia.
Big head.
Had some Time Attack cars here, just a few of them, and had the Green Cup race, which is kind of like an eco race, which is interesting. Frankie S2K, thanks for watching. Tune in from Allentown, PA. Midnight on the East Coast. So some hardcore fans, Ryan, tuning in.
Awesome. Very cool. Well, looks like we've got all of the pieces buttoned up. Now putting the K-rail back into position. Getting the course all safe and sound. And that'll move us on to our next pair, which is Daigo Saito versus Yukio Matsui.
Okay. Yep, there we go. Teramachi moves on. All right, so Saito and Matsui. All right, so we are getting everything settled, but we are almost halfway through with Saito and Matsui. When we come back, we'll see the Ninja, your 2013 Formula Drift Asia champion. He'll be doing battle next when we come back here at Okayama International Circuit.
The brightness. Called brilliant, blinding and vivid, Valenti. Love, driving, Advan. Yokohama, your tire.
The Osaka Auto Messe is a motor show based around the theme of customizing. Be sure to come and find your own special customization that meets your desires at the Osaka Auto Messe.
I know when I toss my car into a turn at over 100 miles per hour, it's going to hold it. If you don't have confidence in your tires, you have nothing.
Van. Yokohama, your tire. The brightness. Called brilliant. Blinding and vivid. Valenti.
We are back here as Ryan grabs a few snacks as we are going to be snacking down on some good competition as Daigo, the Ninja Saito, is going against Yukio Matsui for our next battle. Matsui and that R-Magic FDRX7. Definitely a cool-looking car, but Daigo Saito, a force to be reckoned with. 2013 Formula Drift Asia Championship. Look at that quick little snap of the wrist, and the R-Magic FDRX7 almost gets in the back of Saito, gets phased by the Achilles radial tires. Saito pulls out and away from the exited clutch FDRX7. Woo! Gets tight to that outside clipping zone. Man, can you blame him? I mean, that was a gang of smoke that Saito put out in Yukio's face. Ryan, Saito, one of the best in the biz. Just a gangster initiation. Really settled, really strong showing out front. And, can you blame Yukio for getting phased?
Known for his chase runs, but right now lays down a pretty phenomenal lead run. Talking to Frederick Osbo, said Daigo Saito's car is about a second quicker than a lot of other cars in competition around this track. And you can see right there in the chase position, Yukio Matsui having a tough time staying with Saito on initiation. That was the key point in this match so far. Saito running away with it at this point, playing catch up here as Matsui, but that big mistake on initiation definitely going to cost him an advantage. But now Saito will be chasing him down. You can see Matsui straightens up again right there, just desperately trying to gain ground, get something back against Saito, but unable to in that first run, as now our 2013 Formula Drift Asia champion will make his way back to the line to chase down Yukio Matsui.
All right, so Daigo Saito, you can see getting back to the start line. He's in the chase position as Matsui will be leading with that deficit, unfortunately. Fortunately for him, but Saito very comfortable. All right, here we go. Let's see. Oh, nice flick. Good initiation. Alternating the roles, coming into view of the naked eye of the judges. Matsui, good showing. Daigo Saito cannot be shaken with that big mistake by Matsui on that first run. Saito's doing everything he needs to do to gain the victory and advance on. It looks like the exit R-Magic FD of Yukio Matsui will be knocked out with that mistake out of the gate. So Saito should be advancing on, Ryan.
Yeah, no doubt about it. This whole battle has basically been completely owned by Daigo Saito. It's a great initiation right here by Matsui. You can see Daigo just a little bit wider right there, trying to preempt the movements of where Matsui is headed. You can see Matsui is on a nice line right here, stays nice and wide. Daigo's right there, very close on proximity. Good transition right here by Matsui. And then Daigo starts to attack right here as they get to outer zone number two. Gets on the throttle, dives in door to door right here, basically. Really tightening it up right here as they come through the guillotine, pass through into the final turn as they transition uphill into this last and final inside clip. Saito still right on that back bumper of Matsui. And after that first run, that's pretty much going to be all she wrote for Yukio Matsui.
All right, so here we go. Yukio Matsui, Daigo Saito. And let's make it official. Lantane, Yoshihara, and Andy Yen. Say Daigo Saito, the ninja, advances on to the Great Eight. We're now officially halfway through our top 16. Local time 2 o'clock. Thank you for the hardcore fans. Midnight there on the East Coast. Right on, Lewis. Lewis Holm, watching from home, from New Zealand. Sure, bro. Here we go, Ryan, with our next battle. This is Yokoi versus S. Yokoi has been absolutely on fire, but S has been driving probably the best I've ever seen him drive. But look at the angle from Yokoi. He does touch dirt. That will be a deduction, as exciting as it looks. Yokoi pushing just a little too hard as S. Look at that. S showing some great composure. hardly any wavering from him, even with Yokoi pushing hard. Great showing by both these guys, but Ryan, Yokoi going off, I think the judges are kind of going to frown upon that.
Yeah, I didn't think it was that big of a tire drop for it to be a huge, huge swing in the direction of S, but S drove really well. So you can see right here on initiation, both drivers come into the first turn together, this long right-hand sweeper. This is where Yokoi goes very, very deep, just threading the needle here, has that tire drop, and it's really just for a second or two. You can see S, like you said, very composed, stays tucked in right there, doesn't get phased in the smoke cloud. Yokoi comes into that first inside clip, is able to hit that pretty well. S unable to be shaken, he stays with Yokoi all the way through. So this is a good battle back and forth by both competitors as we finish up the run here, head up the hill, and cross the finish line.
Right on. Well, seeing some fans, look at that, getting tattooed, getting a steak, and watching FD, the Club Loose Gang. ECFU, buddy. As looks like Chris Cheeser, Front Street. How we doing? All right, Ryan. As we will now see. S will be out front. Masashi Yokoi, who we talked about it, FDUS competitors, look out. Yokoi will be here competing next year. He talked about petitioning, so we could see an S15 next year competing at Formula Drift US. Here comes S out front as Yokoi. Wow, look at Yokoi. Wow! Want to do the Japanese yell. As look at that, drops into formation, probably the best transition chase I've seen. Oh, it's S, look at that. Wow, look at the composure. Yokoi, great composure, maintained the angle, dove in, even though S was lacking the angle. Yokoi is just like, dude, get out of the way. Watch this again. The way Yokoi kept his composure through the guillotine, you saw S lack the angle, but Yokoi was right there.
Great job of chase driving right here. You can see S taking the lead, coming into this long sweeper right here. Good angle, trying to find that angle to lock into, the line to lock into, going as deep as he possibly can. Look at Yokoi maxing out the angle on the same line as Yokoi, as S does not go deep enough into that first outer zone. He misses the first inside clip. And then right here, very impressive by Yokoi, maxing the angle out to stay door-to-door right here, not making contact as S straightens up a little bit on the lead position, surging forward, almost passing S right there at that point, but safe nonetheless. Great job by Yokoi in the chase position, coming back around now and really, really dominating this chase run right here against S Westlake.
Man, like I said, for you U.S. competitors, look out for Yokoi coming next year. We talked about S15. What power plant? It's TBD, to be decided. But, man, hats off to the last TIE fighter that is S, flying that TIE flag. Ryan, that's the best I've ever seen S drive. I mean, you know, this overall event. Obviously not right there, but Yokoi just outshined him, outdrove him, and outchased him. So Yokoi gets the win. Yokoi advances on to the Great Eight.
Well, Jared, you know, we're very lucky to be able to go to a lot of these events, if it's in, you know, Southeast Asia or here in Japan,
Australia,
and see a lot of different driving styles. And I got to tell you, you know, I definitely agree that that's the best we've seen S drive. But for drivers at home wanting to know what level of competition drivers here are at, Yokoi is definitely up there.
All right, here we go on to our next battle. This is Fujinaka versus Waki. So Fujinaka out front in the FDRX7, the Magic FDRX7. And there we have Waki AQM S14. Oh, coming through the keyhole. The FDRX7 of Fujinaka having a bit more angle than the chase car of Waki. Liking the RX7 right now of Manabu. Good showing. Ryan, let's take a look at it again.
So here we go. Manabu Fujinaki and Yoshiaki Waki. Both drivers coming down the front straight. Fujinaki taking that lead position. Initiates right there. E-brake for a little bit. Trying to set himself up. Get online. You can see Waki in the chase position. Falls back a little bit. Both drivers staying wide here. Nice job in the lead position by Fujinaki to reach out wide on that outer zone. Transitions right here, stays close on that inside clip. A little bit more angle by Waki in the chase position on that inner clip number one. Both drivers shoot through outer zone number two. A little bit of separation here as they come through the guillotine. Now Waki trying to close up the back door as Fujinaki rounds out this last turn, heads up the hill. Good run by both guys, maybe giving a slight advantage here to Fujinaki for that pretty clean line and being able to have some sense of separation at certain parts of the course against Waki.
All right, so Waki will now be leading as Fujinaka will be given chase. Now, Fujinaka qualified 7th, Waki qualified 10th, so they're kind of in the same vicinity as far as driving ability, but when it comes to chasing, it's a whole different game, and some of these guys have not chased or done battle against each other before, so how are they going to keep their composure? What are they going to do? But, you know, again, seat time. Yokoi, Kawabata, those are the drivers that get a lot of seat time. Daigo Saito, you know, Frederick Osbo, we talked about him and his success, but some of the names that we're going to be seeing that I've been impressed with throughout the day is Andrew Gray. Qualified mid-pack, 14th, but he's somebody really to watch. And then obviously Frederick Osbo, if his car's running healthy, he could very well win this entire thing. Ryan Waki will now be leading as Fujinaka will be given chase through the mandated start chicane. Here comes Waki. Little quick flick initiation from Waki, but look at that, Fujinaka. Waki, some wavering. Fujinaka diving in, not getting to the outside clipping zone, not setting himself up for success. Oh, salvaging. Not the best run there by Fujinaka, making it very apparent that he came off of that rear clipping zone early. Yes, he's chasing, but he did compromise and did not chase Waki exactly mandated by the judges.
Yeah, this is where it gets challenging for the judges to take a look at some of these minor and major errors by both drivers in run one and run two. You can see right here, Waki comes into initiation. Fujinaka in the chase position. Good aggressive move right there by Fujinaka. But then right here, he falls back a little bit right here as he comes off that outer zone early, trying to get some range and distance closer to Waki, but makes a mistake in doing so. We've seen some drivers do that in that position. Waki now takes this last turn here through the guillotine. Fujinaka is able to button up a little bit, get closer to that right rear bumper of Waki, and again on this last transition up the hill. So both drivers making a few mistakes, but I think Fujinaka may have made a more sizable one coming off that first outer zone. We'll have to see if the judges agree here, as it was pretty close battle.
All right, going to the judges, Fujinaka and Waki. Fujinaka in the FDRX7. So even with those mistakes, Ryan Lontaine and Dai Yoshihara and Andy Yen, it's unanimous. So I didn't exactly like how Fujinaka chased him, but as you said, Ryan, was that enough to offset Waki's kind of okay chase run? And no, so obviously it's unanimous. Fujinaka advances on to the Great Eight. So Waki is out. As we have two more battles left in the top 16. Again, happy holidays to all those watching across the globe. As we are just, I don't even know what day it is, the 14th. Man, 11 days till Christmas, less than 2 weeks. It's crazy. All right. So here we go, our next battle. This should be a good one. Akira Harajima versus Andrew Gray. Now, Harajima, he qualified 3rd. This is a tough battle here for Gray, who I like his style, but does he have the tandem chops to chop it up with Harajima? Right now, it looks like Gray is coming in hot. Is it too hot? No, he gets, oh, just as I say that, he touches the dirt. Harajima comes through the keyhole. The door is wide open as Andrew Gray back there quite a bit. And Harajima keeps a consistent distance, but also keeps consistent angle, kept it on the track, put his car in the right places, with Andrew Gray not only struggling to catch up, but did have that mistake there in the chase position in that first sweeping turn.
Well, obviously, Jared, the biggest thing that we notice here is the huge amount of distance between Akira Hirajima and Andrew Gray. From initiation, right on the onset, you can see Hirajima does a great job to stay wide. Good speed flowing through here, and you can see the separation starting already as the four-door trying to chase down the S15 struggles with dropping a tire right here, straightens out a little bit, loses more ground to Hirajima. As Hirajima comes up on that first inside clip, does a pretty good job of filling that second outer zone. At this point, Andrew Gray has to cut the course down a little bit to gain proximity, but still nowhere to be seen as we come into this last and final turn. Gray is able to bring back a few car lengths, but it will be too little too late, as now he's going to have to hope that Hirajima makes a big mistake in that next run for him to have a possibility of winning this round or going for it one more time.
All right. So, Andrew Gray, Dai Yoshihara over here giving me karate chop. For whatever reason, I don't know. He's a violent man for some reason. I give him Kit Kat treats, as you can see on my Instagram. I got some red bean and toast. These are popular in an area, correct? You're not on camera, dude. You don't need to show them. They can't. Ryan Lontaine's eating one. talking about our red bean snacks. Here we go. So here we go. Andrew Gray will be out front. Akira Hirajima giving chase. All right, Andrew Gray, nice initiation. Coming into the sweeping turn. Excuse me. As Andrew Gray, nice job riding the rumble strips. Hirajima. Gray dances in the dirt. Gets a little dirty dance in there. Not talking Patrick Swayze. As Hirajima gets a little Patrick Swayze. Now, Ryan, let's take a look at it again.
Remember, going back to the first run, that huge amount of separation between Gray and Hirajima on this run with Gray out front. Comes into initiation. You can see Hirajima staying a bit conservative, not too close, not pressing the issue too much. You got to wonder if that's his strategy. But you can see Andrew does a nice job of riding that line right there. Hirajima not exactly on the same line that he is. Good job by Andrew on that first inside clip. Fills the second outer zone, just a slight tire drop right there. Hirajima still back quite a ways, playing it pretty safe here. Nice angle, good line right here by Andrew Gray coming up on this last turn as he drives up the hill. And there you can see Hirajima through the smoke cloud. So good lead run right there by Andrew Gray, but taking both runs into consideration, who do the judges think will get the win?
I got to think that Andrew Gray just made a few too many mistakes, a very dynamic driver, but I just don't think his chase game is, and against going against Hirajima, you know, or Hirajima, excuse me, and there it is, two, and there it is, it's unanimous. Akira Hirajima gets the win as Andrew Gray is knocked out. Our final battle of the top 16 is coming up next. That's Frederik Osbo, the Norwegian Hammer, second overall in the Formula Drift Championship in the States, and he's first overall. He's the 2014 Formula Drift Asia Champion. You can see the snorkel out of the hood, housing the V8 under the hood of that GT86 on Hankook tires. He's going against who qualified number 11, Tomokazu Hirota, who I don't know if he has the speed, Ryan, to hang with Frederik Osbo. Ryan, here we go through that start chicane. The Goodyear tires, Mark II. Oh, almost getting into a tussle, a little reminiscent of the Irish lads doing battle. James Dean and Dean Carney there in Seattle. Oh, look at the angle from Osbo. Does not get all the way out to the coordinating red and white rumble strips, but does have great angle. Oh, nice job into the keyhole. Shooting out like a cannon is the Norwegian Hammer. Ryan, take a look at it again with Osbo out front. What do you say?
Well, from the get-go, you can see Frederik Osbo comes down the front straight with a lot of speed and aggression, moving into that middle line right there. And here you can see him trying to swing wide. He does miss that outer zone just a little bit, as you said.
Had to sneeze, I'm sorry.
Good transition right here to interclip number one. Nice job on outer zone number two. Hirota right here does make a mistake. You can see he comes back right there, almost loses drift, and then does it again right there as well. Understeering around as Frederick Osbo transitions back up the hill right here. So that'll be a pretty good advantage for Frederick Osbo in his lead run, now chasing down Hirota.
All right, bless you, Ryan. I commend you on your mid-announcing sneeze there. Looks like your allergies are kicking up, man. Got the wind blowing. It's a little brisk. Got some runny nose, some cold toes.
Wow.
As Osbo will now be chasing down Hirota, and, you know, if Osbo was smart, and he's a smart cookie, you know, he's not just a good looker. He's a good thinker. As Frederick Osbo, hopefully he got some practice with who he was going to potentially go against. I mean, they had minimal head-to-head practice. And, you know, Osbo, this car from, you know, from its inception to now has really gone through a lot of transformation. So here we go. Osbo will now be chasing down Tomokazu Hirota in that Mark II. All right, initiating into the sweeping turn. Osbo trying to get up close to the Mark II, and he does. Good transition. He was off that front clip, though. How the judge is going to look upon that? Hirota did have a big correction going through the keyhole, and now wraps it around, puts a bow on it. There is Hirota out front in that Goodyear Mark II, and Frederick Osbo. Oh, wow, making claims. Let's take a look at it again.
So Frederick Osbo, obviously the advantage in that first run with that big mistake by Hirota in the second run here. He stays aggressive on initiation right here. You can see Hirota trying to stay as wide as he can on this big, long, sweeping right-hand turn. Frederick Osbo maintaining good proximity right here, keeping him in his sights. Good job by Hirota. Just leaves the zone a little bit. Frederick Osbo straightens out for a second right there in the smoke cloud, gets back on it. Does cause him to go wide on that first inside clip. Hirota shooting out towards that second outer zone and the transition to the guillotine and the third outer zone. Osbo staying on a great proximity. That's where the mistake of Hirota was made on the last run. And then Osbo really tightening it up around this last turn right here, sticking that nose in right on the back bumper. And both drivers cross the finish line. So I think the biggest thing between those two runs was just that mistake of the straightening through the guillotine for Hirota should probably cost him. Could almost be a zero, actually.
Yeah, I mean, that was a really big correction for him. All right, our final battle announces that Frederick Osbo gets the win. So, Ryan, our great eight is set. We're going to be seeing Tsutomu Fujio. This is going against Masato Kawabata. Kunihiko, a.k.a. Kuni, Teramachi will be going against Daigo Saito. Then we have Masashi Yokoi against Manabu Fujinaka. Akira Hirojima is going against the Norwegian hammer that is Frederick Osbo. Ryan, can Frederick Osbo make this, you know, just a monumental round on top of, you know, his championship season here for Formula Drift Asia?
Well, we'll find out. He definitely has the momentum in his corner right now. He's obviously has a lot of confidence. He's won the championship. Car looks like it's performing well. He's got a pretty good bracket, but he's got some guys to go through that have been very competitive this weekend. So we'll see if he can make it two wins for the season as he took home that first win of the year in Thailand in January of this year, or March.
Yeah. And that was the final round of the 2013 championship as well as the first round of the 2014 championship. So served double duty there. All right, watching from Montreal, Domo Kunzatek, I believe is how you say your name. As there is the Great Eight, as it's been branded over the years. Shout out to Eric Hill, a.k.a. Hill Kill. Formula Derp is watching. As there we go. We see our first battle already on deck. Let's get on with it. Let's send it. Here in Japan, Kawabata versus Fujio. This should be a good one, Ryan. Here we go. All right, so Fujio out front, our number one qualifier, going against Kawabata, who qualified 24th. Oh, look at this, Fujio, Kawabata. This is a battle of the ages. As Fujio goes off the course, did Kawabata muscle him off course? Transitioning through into the guillotine is Fujio. Kawabata lunging forward, then Fujio. Wrong way, bro. You're supposed to go right. As Fujio, our number one qualifier, Ryan, we got to take a look at it again. Was that Kawabata from the rear giving Fujio the hate tap?
Well, fun to watch right here. Our first battle in the Great Eight. Let's take a look here as Fujio battles Kawabata. Both drivers coming down with intention on this first run. You can see Kawabata right there slotted on the inside.
Ooh, looked like Fujio had a correction.
Yes, slight straightening right there. It causes Kawabata almost make contact with him. Then Fujio has to get back on it, but he goes off course, so that should be at fault to Fujio. Yep. As you can see, Kawabata trying to make a move by not making any contact here. He does miss that first inside clip, but with all that action going on course, I have to imagine the judges will give the fault to Fujio. And then right here, he did that independently, it looks like, yeah.
Most definitely.
So Fujio goes off course. This should be a big advantage right here for Kawabata, who looks really, really strong right now in that chase position, putting himself in a good position to take home a win here if he can get through this next run and put down a good lead against Fujio.
Yeah, I'm sure the judges are going to look at it again. It seemed that Fujio, when he initiated, let's watch it again, he tries to step it out, he initiates, but watch right here, look at gang e-brake, and then straightens. Look at his front tires, really straight, and we're not going off of that. We're showing, look at the vehicle, totally straight. Kawabata has nowhere to go. I mean, for him keeping the composure was pretty right on. Fujio touches the dirt, so there's a deficit there as Fujio straightens out again. Didn't look like there was contact. Watch Fujio. Now Kawabata's just kind of front row seat here. So Fujio brings it in. Yeah, and it looked like he was gonna come up short through the guillotine and it was gonna chop him off. So we no longer give advantage or disadvantage after the first run, but you can see Fujio pulling back to the line. If he's smart, or not if he's smart, but he could potentially take a competition timeout. Will he, or will he know that, man, he's going against Kawabata, who is one of the best in the biz, and really showing it. But Fujio, man, from start has just been a killer. But, Ryan, we looked at it twice, as did the judges, and didn't seem like there was contact. Looked like Fujio just had some major mistakes on initiation and then going through the guillotine.
Well, trying to get eyes right now on Fujio, who has not come back up to the line. You have to imagine that he will either bow out or call an automatic or an automatic competition timeout will be called for him because he's actually back in the pit now, and that should be an automatic competition timeout charged to him. So Kawabata waiting patiently at the line.
All right, so I believe we... All right, so we are here in a competition timeout. That is a five-minute break there for Tsutomu Fujio. So Fujio is in a competition timeout. They're saying he has a broken axle, Ryan.
Which would give us some answers to his performance.
Yeah.
And
axles, what? You don't need those.
illuminate a little bit of what transpired there coming out of the guillotine. So,
axle schmaxle. Well, already some great battles are ensuing. Let everybody know you're watching. Hashtag FDJPN. Drift Cartel's watching Formula Drift in Canada. Mon petit chou. Qu'est-ce que c'est?
Well, Jared, you can see the next pair warming up back there in the grid. We're going to move on to Daigo Saito and Kunihiko Teramachi for this second battle in the Great Eight. Unfortunately for Fujio, he will not only have a deficit, he'll have to replace that axle that was broken and try to make it back out to the line if he wants to have a fighting chance of beating what looks like a very surging Kawabata, peaking at the right time, as they say.
Completely peaking out. Dropped your bandana there, bud. As we obviously have the break here. Thank you again for joining us. We are live. Okayama International Circuit. Fans watching across the globe. Ryan, when will tickets be on sale for round one of Long Beach? What are we looking at there?
I'm going to try to get them on sale before Christmas time, so anybody buying gifts should have an opportunity to do that.
Right on. I mean, that's, yeah. Brandon Wicknick, how we doing, buddy? Wicknick, Josh Putnam, Josh Mendez, how we doing, bud? All right, Ryan, here we go. So we're advancing on to this next battle. We'll revisit that. It looks like it is Kunihiko Teramachi versus Daigo Saito. So Daigo Saito, the ninja, strong, already out of the gate. Man, just blazing a trail. You know, oh, yeah. So Kunihiko shutting it down. Another victim to the vape trail, you know. But Daigo Saito going analog here, burning some tires versus vaping. Take a look at it again.
Well, Jared, if it wasn't enough that there was a huge gap established, the mistake made by Teramachi through the guillotine is definitely going to seal his fate, at least for this first run. You can see Daigo Saito right out of the gate, maxing out the angle. Nice job on the line here. He does not really fill the zone, though. So he does not come out as wide as you'd like him to. It allows him to pull away from Teramachi. But unfortunately, the real action happens right here. As you can see, the angle is maxed out by Teramachi. He's unable to hold that, not enough speed, and then shuts it down right there, allowing Daigo to keep running away. So a big mistake right there, a zero for Teramachi on that first run, and now he will have to try to back it up with something strong as he'll take the lead against Daigo Saito.
Wow, we got little Link. Linking with that. Hey, buddy. Again, happy birthday to you next week. Lincoln Wadette's watching. It's 80-inch LG screen. Steve Topping holding it down there in St. Louis. Wolves everywhere. That STI guy watching again. Morton still watching in Norway, cheering on the Norwegian Hammer as Kunihiko will now lead. Daigo Saito will be giving chase. We need a big mistake, or, you know, Daigo Saito would need to have a big mistake in order for Kunihiko to really advance on. All right, here we go. Kunihiko initiates into the sweeper. Does not get out all the way to the rear clipping zone. Daigo Saito looks like he resets and recalibrates his vehicle there. That is the Mark II. Into that final clip. Look at that. Daigo transitioning prior to Kunihiko. I mean, just look at the foresight that Daigo Saito had. You saw him actually transition even before his competitor.
Well, he's only got one speed, it seems like. There's not a strategy chase and a crazy hardcore competition chase. It's full bore every time. As you know, that Kunihiko Teramachi was sitting on a zero after that first run, trying to pull out something stupendous here to match up against Daigo Saito, but Daigo right out of the gate stays with him. Tons of smoke on course. You can see the proximity right there. Then Teramachi does a good job on that first inside clip. Very nice job on that second outer zone. And then Daigo right here tucks up on the inside, really charges forward, smashing the throttle right here as he's door-to-door with Teramachi. So no major mistakes from Teramachi out front, but unfortunately unable to shake Daigo Saito. And with that zero on the first run, it's going to be Daigo Saito in the final four.
Saito Daigo. Hi. Genki.
Daigo.
All right, so you can see the smile on Daigo Saito's face as the grin keeps on showing. You're a mean one, Mr. Saito. Looks like the Japanese Grinch right there. He's psyched right now.
Yeah.
And his heart grew three times its size as Daigo Saito advances on to the Great Eight, as well as we're finding out that Fujio, unfortunately, is unable to fix his car. That means Kawabata-san advances on into the Final Four. So Kawabata and Saito will be going against each other in the Final Four. Now we're on to the second half of our Great Eight. As Teramachi gets knocked out, Kawabata and Saito taking a look at our...
That's going to be fun.
That should be a killer one. I really like the Fujio and Kawabata battle. Unfortunately, Fujio broke, though.
Yeah.
You know, can Kawabata navigate through Saito's smoke? That seems to be the equalizer, dude.
Yeah.
I mean, those things are just a chimney of Achilles' radial smoke. All right, here we go. Manabu Fujinaka, qualified seventh, going against Masashi Yokoi. So Yokoi qualified second, and I got to say, man, Yokoi goes against either, or sorry, obviously, I think Yokoi's going to kill it right now. I think, you know, Fujinaka is a strong showing, but the way Yokoi has been driving, the composure in the chase position especially, has been really strong. But look at this, right now, Fujinaka is trying to prove me wrong. Here we go. Nice job by Yokoi Fujinaka. Oh, look at that, door-to-door. Tries to nose in on the door of the D-Max S15. Keeps it clean, keeps it off. Oh, just as I say that, looks like Manabu, big correction there. Well, Ryan, here we go. Let's take a gander.
Well, here we go. Both drivers setting up very close to each other right here, coming down the front straight. Yokoi and Fujinaka. Yokoi in the lead position. Nice flick and good initiation right there by Yokoi, but Fujinaka right there on the inside. Both drivers sweeping a nice arc, trying to get as far out to that outer zone as he can as a lead driver. Fujinaka trying to chase him down. You can see Fujinaka off that first inside clip. Did not position himself well, but Yokoi otherwise stays on a mid-high line right there, coming through the guillotine into outer zone number three. Fujinaka unable to be shaken too much, but did fall off a little bit there on the first part of the course, missing that first inside clip. It's a good lead run by Yokoi, a pretty good chase run by Fujinaka. Good battle here, as now the drivers will switch it up.
Okay, I find you. I know where you live. All right, so Yokoi will be chasing down Fujinaka, and that's where I really think he shows a lot of dominance. But Fujinaka is not a slouch by any means. Ryan, this wraps up our Formula Drift season, man. We've been around the world, as far as seven rounds in the States, two in Japan, Australia, Thailand. And it, again, continues next year, Japan, China now. And Canada. Look at this. So that's what I was talking about. Yokoi getting into formation. Nice job. Look at that. Yokoi transition. Ooh. And there. Mirrors the angle. Does get into the dirt. How are the judges going to speculate on that? Or how are they going to kind of digest the line there by Yokoi?
Let's take a look at this, Jared. Here we go back on the replay here at Okayama International Raceway. Fujinaka in the lead, Yokoi in the chase position. Our Great Eight battle on the second half of the bracket. Both drivers initiate. Yokoi is right there on the inside. Nice job right there. Good line by Fujinaka as he tries to shoot out wide. Really getting deep right here, getting right up on the rumble strip. But Yokoi is right there with them along the way. Slight little baller right there by Fujinaka in the chase position. Gets back on it, hits that inside clip. Yokoi is a little bit wide on the inside clip. Watch Yokoi get on the throttle right here. There could have been some separation, but he gets on the gas, really close to the door. It's really good lead run by Fujinaka, too. This is, I think, a lot closer than we suspected it to be with Yokoi and showing so much promise throughout this entire weekend. Fujinaka is doing a pretty good job in the lead position. No slouch is Fujinaka in that RX-7 taking on Yokoi.
All right, so
here we go.
And there it is. Ryan Lontaine says Yokoi. Daioshihara, looks like it will be unanimous. Masashi Yokoi advances on to the final four. Looks like Tanner Bear, nice, watching on a big 120-inch projector. Nice setup there, bro. Sogoi Lincoln. Genki, hi. Niola 86, Devil Zek. Got some port wine there. Nice. All right, well, Ryan, so we are seeing Kawabata with his bye run. We already know that he advanced on, but just a little style for Miles here.
Well, it's an interesting potential Final Four that's matching up after we get into this next battle with Hirajima and Frederick Osbo. Mm-hmm. It will be one of those two guys that will be facing Yokoi, and then on the other side of the bracket, we've got Daigo Saito and Kawabata.
Whoa. Making me a little nervous there. Kawabata dancing with the guillotine there. Could get cut, man. Hello to the Drift Cartel from Quebec. Chan Ronnie Lim, how we doing? All right, Ryan, you could see Frederick Osbo there on the left. He will be chasing because Hirajima qualified higher. Hirajima. I said Hirajima. Daioshihara is trying to correct my Japanese over here, Ryan.
Yeah, what does he know?
Aren't you Mexican, Dai? I thought you were Mexican. This whole time? Isn't it Daijiro? Daijiro. Roll the R. Roll the R, Vato Loco. Here we go. Akira versus Osbo. Look at that initiation from Osbo. But Hirajima. Oh, look at this. So Osbo falling back.
Uh-oh.
His first kind of chink in the armor. Will the now newly crowned champion?
Oh, look at this!
Oh, we're going toe to toe. It is a full on grappling match here as Hirajima almost went into the wall. Osbo had to dance around him. We did the Japanese yell. We fully did the.
We did.
We committed to it.
Well, that was really fun to watch. Let's take a look at it now on the replay as Hirajima in the lead position, Frederick Osbo in the chase. Now, like you said, Jared, definitely seen some separation here. Osbo dives in early, tries to maintain close proximity to Hirajima, but you can see Hirajima shallows up a little bit. He pulls away from Frederick Osbo. Now, this is the biggest gap established, but watch what happens. Hirajima comes in with too much speed from that inside clip, pushes a little bit too hard, almost hits a wall. It allows Frederick Osbo to take up position and really close the door, almost making contact right there as they transition to the last part of the course uphill right here and into that last inside clip. And you can see Hirajima goes way wide and almost drops two tires right there. Oh, little kiss right there by Frederick Osbo. So both drivers pulling out all the stops, some mistakes by Hirajima that allowed Frederick Osbo to tuck back on the inside. And Hirajima with a slight distance gap between the last part of outer zone number one and inner clip number one. Now, he did shallow up to be able to do that, but it wasn't that big of a deal, so I think the judges will go back and forth on just who had the advantage throughout the run, but nonetheless, very exciting to watch.
All right, so I'm seeing Frederick Osbo. Are we seeing him pull in the pits?
I think Hirajima pulled into the pits.
Okay, so
Hirajima.
All right, you can see Kevin Wells down there on the line. Flagging for, okay, so there's Hirojima. Coming back out now, you can see the RSR team inspecting the vehicle.
So that's going to be an automatic five.
They don't have hands on the car.
Oh, yeah, that's right. This could be safety. They did make contact.
Yeah.
Is there anything underneath there? Any animals? Any deer parts?
Oh. Thank you for all the notes, all the fans watching. All right, so again, thank you for all the fans watching here. Hashtag FDJPN. All right, getting some word from Kevin Wells down there. Taking a look, and Ryan, you said if they have contact, the judges need to deem fault to one of the drivers in order for, if basically Osbo was at fault, Hirojima would be allowed to put hands on the car.
Well, I think the contact I was referring to was actually after the finish line.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's what's going on. There was a slight bump after the finish line, so that is not within the confines of competition, so the rule book wouldn't necessarily apply here on fault. It allowed basically for safety, both vehicles to be inspected by the tech manager, make sure we're good to go, and then we'll rock it out for the second part of this run here, second part of the battle.
All right. Got Omar watching from Dominican Republic, Sam Pirtle, Joey Redmond's watching, Wrecked Magazine, Drift Builder, Brock Sawyer, and for those fans wanting to hear the live Nat car audio sound, we've requested it. We don't have any microphones down on track, so obviously want you to
just make the noises with your mouth.
Yeah. No, but in all seriousness, obviously, we'd love to make everybody happy, but over the last 11 years, definitely, that's impossible. As now Osbo Domokan Saint Germain, man, got a bunch of clips here watching FDJPN. Ryan, you could see the GT86.
So want to get this battle concluded before we go on to our final four battle here. Now both drivers coming to the line.
The brightness, called brilliant, blinding and vivid, bounty. Love, driving, Advan. Yokohama, your tire.
Okay, Ryan, we are seeing our drivers back to the start line. Osbo will now lead, who qualified sixth and is officially your 2014 Formula Drift Asia champion. I like to include the Australasia as well as Thailand, because it does include Down Under. So Kawabata, Saito, and Yokoi are in the final four. Who will join them? Hirojima or the Norwegian Hammer Osbo? All Three drivers already in, flying the Japanese flag. Will a Norwegian join them, or will it be another Japanese driver, Akira Hirajima? Here we go. So Osbo out front initiates faint transition into the sweeping turn. Here comes the RSR GT86. Just dancing against the rumble strip as Osbo transitions into the guillotine. Nice job filling up that rear clipping zone, and another. Let's see how we do coming up the hill and into the front clip. Nice job by both the drivers. Now, Ryan, assessing that run and the lead run, who do you think has it? I mean, that was a great lead run by Osbo, and Hirajima was there the entirety, man. He was right there, a little bit of bobbling from him, but strong showing.
Yeah, here we go. Let's take a look at this second run, then we can talk about the first one, see what we think. You can see Osbo right there, e-brake entry, comes into this first long right-hand sweeper. Hirajima right there on his back bumper, maintaining good angle, trying to stay on the line as Frederick Osbo sweeps wide to that first outer zone. Good transition right there into the first inside clip. You can see Hirajima was a little bit wide there. Now Osbo really gets on the throttle right here, pushes through, is able to establish a little bit of a gap. As you can see, Hirajima straightens out just a little bit, loses a little bit of angle. And then the last corner right here, Osbo comes up the hill, and Hirajima is right there with him finally. So the first run, yeah, we saw, you know, Hirajima actually pull a little bit of a gap, but then give some of it back to Frederick Osbo as he went deep and wide here. So if you say that run was even, would it go to Frederick Osbo on the second run?
Oh, man. Yeah, I'd have to say Osbo got it on that second one. And look at that. Osbo gets the win. So Frederick Osbo takes down Hirajima, so it's not an all-Japanese final. Frederick Osbo, who is your champion of 2014 Asia Championship, continues and could just put an exclamation point, kind of a bookend. Started out the season strong with the win in Thailand, and is he going to end it here in Japan at, you know, a story track? Again, Ayrton Senna holds the fastest lap still to this day. Schumacher's won here before, and is the Norwegian Hammer going to have just a great event? The best four, the final four is set. We have, Kawabata and Saito, and now it is Yokoi and Osbo. Shout out to Alex Dabrowski and also Paul Ho, from Hankook Tires. He's watching as well. And Hankook Tires is in the final four.
So this is going to get interesting here. I mean, this is an incredible final four. I think you'd have to agree, Jared. We've been talking about Yokoi all weekend. Obviously, a lot of excitement around Kawabata coming to the event this weekend as well. Obviously, everybody knows Daigo Saito and Frederick Osbo. So we're seeing what is a fairy tale final four here.
Yeah.
Here's our first battle between these two titans of drift in Kawabata and Saito.
All right, so as far as third place, that is decided now by qualifying. So Kawabata qualified 24th, excuse me, easy for me to say.
Dwarf,
that's a new number. Qualified 24th, Daigo Saito qualified 5th, Yokoi qualified 2nd, and Osbo qualified 6th. So at minimum, Yokoi is guaranteed a podium. So Masashi Yokoi is guaranteed a podium. All right, so this is our first battle, Kawabata versus Daigo Saito. All right, so Daigo Saito will be leading, Kawabata giving chase. These two giants of the drifting world are competing under the Formula Drift banner. Here we go, Daigo the Ninja Saito. Oh, Kawabata,
oh!
Big correction. He goes almost off course, salvages it, and another victim to, whoa, Kawabata! Goes off course, saves it as Saito rips away. Kawabata comes away unscathed, but parks it in the kitty litter. Man, every single battle is decided between Saito in that first corner. Let's take a look at it again, Ryan.
Well, Jared, yes, every battle against Daigo has happened in that first corner. I think because he's so fast and because the smoke cloud is so thick, drivers know that that is their one and only opportunity to stay close in proximity. They have to push as hard as he can, but even with the quickness of Kawabata's car, he gets lost in the smoke or makes a mistake. Something happens there, and he gets offline. We don't see him again until right there, but by this time, Daigo is all over it. Kawabata quickly gets on throttle, tries to get back into it, but overestimates The throttle control goes offline. He goes into the kitty litter. Daigo makes it around without any further mistakes. So once again, Saito will go into his chase run, potentially, if Kawabata makes it to the line, with a pretty sizable advantage.
So Daigo Saito continues out the course. We'll get Kawabata out of the kitty litter. Pull out the sand wedge. That is a Suzuki in this instance. Gets him safely out of the sand. All right, we're seeing thumbs up from Kawabata. Hats off to the Okayama International Circuit safety crew and track crew, really expediting the cleanup services and keeping it nice. So hats off to them. As Kawabata makes his way around the track. Look at that, driving the whole track as off track as much as he can. So that was a nice cordial thing to do as Daigo Saito patiently awaits. Look at the poke on the front end there, really sticking beyond the fenders in Saito's Mark II.
Here we go one more time, Jared.
Yeah, Ryan.
On this replay, we'll see if we can make any further inquiries into what happened in the smoke cloud, but I don't think that we will be able to see exactly what happened to Kawabata's car. You could see on initiation, it looks like he made a mistake, and then obviously he had to deal with the smoke cloud, but this is the result of that as he tried to play catch up there, nearly hitting the tire barricade,
yeah,
but going off course, and now he's got a big hill to climb as he'll get an opportunity to take a lead, but of course, never fun when Daigo's chasing you.
All the fans watching online, diehard fans, who would you like to see compete next year in Formula Drift, stateside or internationally? Who are some of your favorite drivers across the globe that might not even compete in Formula Drift that you'd like to see? As we said, Yokoi could be entering into Formula Drift stateside competition, as well as competing, obviously, in the Japan round next year. And, you know, going to see a lot of drivers in Canada, as Ryan explained. China, I would call it an invitational. You have to qualify.
Not an invitational,
because you could choose whoever you want, but a qualify. You have to qualify. All right, so here we go. Kawabata out front with going off course. He has a deficit, and the Sunoco Pro Drive on Achilles Radial JZX 100 Mark II of Daigo Saito will be giving chase. Thumbs up. Lights illuminate and go off. All right. Wow, look at Kawabata ripping out of that start chicane. Here we go. Kawabata out front. Oh, it's Saito.
No, okay. It's going to be a cone.
Okay, bye.
All right, yep.
All right, so we're seeing a restart here. I thought that Saito shut her down. So, yeah, did you see Kawabata, like, kick it out real quick?
Yeah, or he was going to do the biggest weight transfer you've ever seen.
Are you not entertained? Kawabata and Saito, enter.
That's why Roger Pedactor's dead.
Who's Roger?
Roger Pedactor?
Yeah.
Come on, Ace Ventura.
Ah. Do you know him? Does he call you on the phone? Okay. This is Ryan Sage, Jared Dienda here, your tour guides for Formula Drift Japan, the final round of the Australasia Championship, Formula Drift Asia Championship overall. Here we go, Kawabata out front, sitting on that big mistake, going off course, Daigo Saito.
Oh,
couple car lengths as Kawabata gets into the dirt as Saito navigates around him. Chucks a deuce, and Saito pretty much has to pass Kawabata. As I mean, more than half the car was off the course, so Kawabata with a major mistake out front. That's going to hand Daigo Saito the win, as Kawabata will basically be fourth place in this instance if we make it official.
Well, you got to wonder if Kawabata was mentally shaken after that first run. You can see very, very hot into the first corner. Tries to modulate the speed. There's one tire, there's two. Now the entire car, except for the front right, is off course. Daigo on the inside makes the pass. And pretty much now it's off to the races, as there's no coming back from that unless you repass.
Nah, it's out.
So it's only happened once in history.
Yeah, that was shut down the internet. All right, waiting for the results after this replay. And slide them right, boys.
Diego
Santos, as he's known in Mexico, as well as Daigo Saito, the ninja, gets the win and is in the finals. Who is Saito going to go against? Will it be Yokoi or Osbo?
Well, wouldn't it would be if it was Osbo, Saito, that would be interesting, because maybe a little bit of payback for Irwindale.
Ooh. Yeah. And both of them are in different cars.
Yeah.
You know, Formula Dread, hats off to him. He made the statement. He says, dude, Osbo's the man. He goes against a sea of V8s in the States in a four-cylinder turbo, and in a sea of two JZs comes over here with a V8.
Right. That's
interesting. He's kind of the platypus in the mix, man.
Yeah.
Just really, really changing things up. So the variety.
What's the platypus reference? How does that work?
Just a unique kind of creature in the jungle of animals.
Could it be a chameleon because he changes all the time to accommodate his environment?
It could be a chameleon if that makes you feel warm and fuzzy.
I like it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is he a karma chameleon?
that I don't know.
Loving was easy. Living a life like dream.
Yeah.
Red, gold, and green.
Yeah, and green.
Well, Frederick Osbo is known for his blue steel, his Ferrari good looks. Could we call him Frederick Zoolander Osbo?
We can. I mean, that video is online to be seen now. I mean, there's no hiding it.
It is. Orange mocha frappuccinos all around on the podium as we celebrate Frederick Osbo's championship. But he is not to the line yet. Yokoi, who qualified second, will be leading, as Osbo qualified sixth.
You can see Osbo coming around the corner. That's actually where the only official warm-up area is on this facility.
Look at the angle from that car.
Yeah, the track does not allow burnouts down the front straight, and so they have a pad around the corner. That's where the drivers have to warm up their tires.
All right, well, here comes the chameleon, as Ryan calls him. Frederick Osbo, the Norwegian Hammer, V8, RSR, GT86 on Hankook tires, against Yokoi. Masashi Yokoi in the D-Max S15. Yokoi will be leading, qualifying second. Will it be Yokoi or Osbo against Saito in the finals? We already know that Kawabata is out, and qualifying 24th puts him out of even the third place podium position. Here we go. Send it. Yokoi initiates, as does Osbo. Coming down the hill into that first sweeper, into the first rear clipping zone. Yokoi gets out there. Osbo, little less angle. Set himself up. Potential success here. Whoa! Getting that proximity door-to-door, wheel-to-wheel is Osbo and Yokoi. But Osbo almost applies too much pressure, having to back off and distance himself from Yokoi. Let's hit replay and check out what unfolded here for Yokoi out front as Osbo was chasing.
Yeah, here we go. You can see Osbo coming out very hot. Yokoi taking the initiation right here, does a great job. Now, he will get the better of this exchange between Osbo, in my opinion. You can see he stays a lot wider in this zone. He has good angle here. Yokoi goes right to the outside. Osbo on the inside right here. He does go a little bit wide, loses a little bit of angle on that inside clip, but staying close enough to make it a competitive battle. Really diving in right here is Osbo. Yokoi, nice job on that third outer zone coming through the guillotine. Door-to-door action right here as Osbo falls back a little bit to reposition himself to try to get back up on the inside. So a pretty good lead run right here by Yokoi. Osbo following it back up with a decent chase. Got ourselves a good battle on hands as now Frederick Osbo will take the lead against Yokoi.
Seemed that Osbo was on it. He, you know, had the good chase strategy, but then, like I said, like you said, the pressure, and then had to back off. So here we go. Osbo will now be out front. Masashi Yokoi will be giving chase.
Well, Yokoi making claims about coming to the U.S. to compete next year. This is obviously the first time he'll have competed against a fellow FD driver from the States. And doing well so far.
Wow, look at Yokoi right there. Whoa! Oh! Contact from Yokoi to Osbo.
Oh, man.
So Yokoi in that chase position, we'll have to assess and see what transpired here. Was it Osbo coming to a halt? Was it Yokoi just getting too aggressive? I mean, Yokoi was right there.
Well, this battle is going to all come down to fault on contact. If we find that the judges go with Frederick Osbo, they'll have said that Yokoi was too aggressive on the attack. If it goes to Yokoi, it'll be that Osbo slowed down too much into the corner unnecessarily. But let's take a look. This is in slow motion. Nice initiation by Osbo. No real usage of the e-brake right there. Nice fluidity, but you can see Yokoi does a pretty good job on the inside, coming in very hot. Didn't see e-brake by Osbo in that area, so it seems like that he was on throttle. I'd like to see that one more time, or at least not braking.
Yeah, I mean, it really does seem that Yokoi just goes into Osbo. I mean, you know, even if Osbo slowed down a little bit, that doesn't warrant Yokoi running into him. He would need to modulate his car control and get into position and drop back, because Yokoi was quite a bit of distance ahead, car position-wise, of Osbo. You want to see him drop back because, yeah, Osbo wasn't the deepest into that rear clipping zone. The judge is requesting another replay, so obviously you, the fans, will be seeing this again.
And when it comes to braking, there's two things that we can keep an eye on. One is obviously the handbrake. You can actually see the rear wheels braking. The other is we have lights on top of the vehicle that show
both
the actual
back
foot brake. So let's see if we can keep an eye on that. See, no e-brake here, no e-brake here, no e-brake here. Don't see any lights illuminating.
Yeah.
The lights are actually just right above the windshield banner on the front and on the back. And you should be able to see them.
I mean, you can't overthink it. Unfortunately, I just think Yokoi was too aggressive.
Yeah, I mean, the first thing you see, the first instinct is what it is, you know, unless it's a very, very nuanced call that really takes requiring actually going back and looking at all the angles that we have at our disposal. But from those two angles right there, it doesn't seem like there is any apparent unnecessary slowdown braking from Frederick Osbo.
I mean, like we said, if he slowed down, you know, okay, well, so Ryan, you know, we're getting some words from the start line. The naked eye, it didn't look like Osbo slowed down dramatically. He might have slowed down a little bit, but again, as a chase car, I mean, where are you kind of leaning at? Let's open the dialogue.
Yeah, I mean, There's no braking from Osbo that you can see on the e-brake, and there's no front and rear lights. But are there other ways that you can modulate and slow down the car, you know, is the question. I mean, we probably need to see that in full speed.
Yeah, definitely full speed. Slow motion, because we're not seeing the wheel stop. We're not seeing the brake lights on. It needs to be, knee-jerk. Where's it happen? Is he slowing down dramatically in order to mess up Yokoi? Is it foul play is basically what we're kind of looking for.
It doesn't
here.
Have to be foul play. It can just be, you know.
Did he slow down?
A positioning, you know, technique to try to get where he wants to on the line, but.
Right, but, I mean, that could also, you know.
But we're not seeing his throttle. He's just letting the car.
So some of the judges saying not seeing throttle, you know, no smoke line in that area, potentially from Osbo. I think, you know, I hear it sounds like some of the guys are maybe leaning towards Osbo with fault there. It's really hard for me to I guess justify that.
Yeah, I'm erring on the side of Yokoi in the chase position, even though Osbo might have been going fairly slow by comparison to even previous. It didn't seem that abrupt, and it didn't seem like a violent slowing of the car.
Right.
Because he was drifting, he was approaching the rear clipping zone, and yeah.
And the entry speed that we're seeing here has been consistent, but that's not the area of contention here.
So the judges are conversing. Well, Ryan, that was the second battle of this battle of Yokoi and Osbo. So Saito's already in the finals.
Either way, it's going to be controversial, you know? I mean, so the booth trying to pull up a different angle here.
Ryan, are we hearing confirmation about whose fault it is?
Well, it's the second run, so we won't know fault until there's a victor.
True.
That's what I'm saying. If it goes to,
I know, but I'd still like to hear, like, because that's kind of, you know, that contributes to the verdict. But also, you know, if this was the first run, I'd like to, you know, they would deem somebody at fault so the cars could be fixed. Regardless, whoever wins will get time to work on their car, but how much time, too, because if they sustain a lot of damage.
Well, there's going to be, I mean, whoever, you mean whoever wins?
Yeah, I guess that does decide, that does dictate
yeah,
who wins.
You'll know which way each judge voted on the fault by the way that this score comes up. If it goes, yeah.
All right, so Ryan Lantain says it was Yokoi. So, okay, and yep. As does Dai Yoshihara, Andy Yen says. So Yokoi gets the win. Yokoi gets the win as, you know, I did over here. It was 2-1 as far as fault. That's what I heard over here. And but as far as the judges go, Yokoi gets the win. So with that, it is unanimous as far as the verdict goes, but I am hearing as far as the at fault in that incident, they are saying they're split 2-1 over there.
No, they're not split. They said after the last replay, they're all unanimous at fault.
Okay. So that last replay really sealed the deal.
Yep.
All right.
For me, I get it. I get it. I could see that, but it's hard to make that call. But you know, that's the position that they're in. You know, it's so much easier if you can explain to fans and people to watch. Hey, there's the brake lights. Hey, there's the e-brake. But that's not the only way you can slow down the car.
No.
And, you know, ultimately that's the decision that they went with.
Right. Right. All right. Well, you know, the caliber of driver we're seeing is second to none. This is the final round of Formula Drift Asia, and we are seeing that Frederick Osbo grabs third place, and our finals are set. It's an all-Japanese battle. It's Daigo Saito versus Masashi Yokoi. When we come back, the finals are set here at Okayama International Circuit.
The brightness, called brilliant, blinding and vivid, bounty.
Love, driving, Advan. Yokohama, your tire.
The Osaka Auto Messe is a motor show based around the theme of customizing. Be sure to come and find your own special customization that meets your desires at the Osaka Auto Messe.
I know when I toss my car into a turn at over 100 miles per hour, it's going to hold it. If you don't have confidence in your tires, you have nothing.
Love driving. Advan. Yokohama, your tire.
The brightness called brilliant. Blinding and vivid. Valenti.
The Formula Drift Japan finals are set. We're live at Okayama International Circuit. This is Jared Dienda. Local time is 3:25 p.m. on Sunday, December 14th. Jared Dienda, Ryan Sage. Ryan, it's been a great weekend out here. A little bit cold, a little bit windy off and on, but the sun is out for the finals. Is this kind of what you expected, Ryan? I mean, look at this. I mean, Yokoi qualified second. Daigo Saito qualified fifth. But, you know, and Frederick Osbo, who grabs the championship, also grabs that final podium spot. Coming into this round, is this what you expected?
You know, it was hard to say exactly what to expect coming into this event because we had seen Yokoi, we had seen Osbo, we had seen Fujio do very well. We'd seen him in previous rounds. We hadn't seen Daigo's new car perform, so we had really no basis for that. Obviously, it's performing well. But no, I'm not too surprised about Yokoi Osbo. I could have very easily seen Kawabata near the podium, which he got very, very close. I could have also seen, you know, guys like Teramachi do well, which they did. But I think in terms of the podium, we're kind of seeing, you know, the leaders of the series really pull through here and put down a strong performance.
All right, so we are seeing Saito and Yokoi. And, man, you know, I don't like to see those kind of interesting calls there, as we saw against Yokoi and Osbo, but it's how the cookie crumbled. And I got to say, overall, I think the driving by Yokoi, he's very deserving to be in the finals. The way he's driven, the way he's chased. Frederick Osbo, that car is a beast. He's a phenomenal driver. Is the car absolutely dialed? You know, it still has some development, I think. I mean, that car being debuted, was it last season? Did it get debuted last season? I think late last season it got debuted, and it's a beast. But the RSR team is always working on it, consistently working on it. But
Well, yeah. I'll tell you one thing. You know, we can put an end to the controversy because Frederick will tell you the truth.
Yeah.
He'll tell you if he made a mistake there, you know, and was not on throttle or not positioned properly for there to be contact. I mean, he's honest enough to tell you that.
Yeah, he's definitely, you know, he's a stand-up guy. He's in line with the spirit of it. And here he is, you know, speaking on Frederick Osbo's behalf. You talk to him, and he talks about watching Formula Drift. He talks about watching D1, which obviously had a lot of the drivers he's going against. If it's Yokoi, if it's Daigo Saito, if it's Kuni, you know, if it's Keiichi Tsuchiya, Arido, Taniguchi, and now he is part of drifting DNA worldwide. And he's a constant ambassador in his native Norway, and here he is in Japan, again, Australia, in the States, and, you know, he gains a lot of attention because he's an advocate and an ambassador for drifting.
Well, if there's young drivers out there that, you know, are looking for somebody to admire, to look up to, sometimes when you admire somebody or you have somebody that's a hero, you're always placing your faith in them because you don't know if they're going to, you know, be the type of athlete that's going to go and do things that are against your, you know, your moral code or
right.
whatever, end up, you know, having a violent outbreak or some of the things we've seen in other sports. Frederick Osbo is one of those kind of guys that you can have pure confidence in that he can be somebody that you can look up to. Because not only is he a great competitor, he's really a truly, genuinely a nice guy and a cool dude to be around.
Right. No, I agree with that. Who is not one? Sorry, I just had to put you out there. No, it's okay. Let's not name names. It's okay.
Gee, let me think.
This guy Got to put you on blast there. Yeah. And you could say me. It's cool.
No, we've had our moments. Usually they're off camera, though.
Oh, wow. Thanks, Ryan. Appreciate that.
Jared, he's a good man. He's a wonderful husband. And what else do you do?
Father.
Father.
Yeah, thanks.
Father.
Jeez.
The voice of everything.
Vaughn called me the voice of everything. Awesome. But that only gives credit to everything I announced.
Right.
No, it's been an absolute honor and pleasure. You know, hopefully we made you laugh. You know, some of you are crying because your driver particularly lost, but it's been a pleasure to be part of Formula Drift history and motorsports history, and as we are here. But, you know, as I said, I honestly can't make everybody happy, but at least I hopefully made you chuckle at least once this year. And it's been one for the record books, as we saw Chris Forsberg grab the Formula Drift Domestic Championship, Frederick Osbo grab second, and here we are, the final set, as Frederick Osbo officially locks up the 2014 Formula Drift Asia Championship. We're seeing Daigo the Ninja Saito, 2012 Formula Drift champion, in his scenario. Noco Pro Drive Achilles Radial JZX 100 Mark II going against the S15 D-Max vehicle of Masashi Yokoi. Yokoi will be leading as he qualified second, and with Frederick Osbo qualifying sixth, he grabs that third podium spot. So Daigo Saito qualified fifth, will be giving chase. Are you ready, Japan? Are you ready, world? Who's going to grab the first ever Formula Drift Japan final round here at Okayama International Circuit? So, Yokoi and Saito. All right, so we are seeing our next battle and the final battle on deck, but you can see the RSR team behind the start line, and we are getting word that there is a protest. There is a protest in regards to that last battle of Osbo and Yokoi. Now, how this is mandated or structured is that the team needs to protest, they need to submit a monetary amount of money, and they need to review it. So we are finding out or seeing if this is warrantable of a review to great extremities, because it comes down to mile per hour on initiation. Was it within the tolerances of previous runs? That's why we grab the speeds. So are we going to see a reversal of this call? Basically, we've seen a couple different angles from the front, from the back. So as we thought we were set for the finals, we are seeing, you can see Kevin Wells there on the start line. He is our correspondent talking. So they're saying, Kevin, I could see him, universal hand signal for, do some circle burners, keep the tires warm in the skid pad area. That is okay. But Yokoi is still on the start line, and the RSR GT86 So Yokoi and Osbo, so those two gentlemen went at it. So you could see Frederick Osbo back there. So as Ryan said, tickets will ideally go on sale before Christmas for Long Beach, kicking off once again in April. Our seven routes have been announced, as We are going back to Florida once again. Texas, all the previous rounds, the venues are changing, but international-wise, the World Championship includes Japan, Canada, and China, as the vehicles will be heading right after Irwindale straight to China. And that is based purely off qualifying. And as he said, 7 accumulative rounds, which could include just one or both. So mathematically, a world champion would be crowned. You know, you have a better shot, obviously, if you go to Japan, Canada, and the 7 rounds. You'll then go to China with that being the final round of the World Championship. So 10 rounds accumulative, we'll see. So as Ryan gets back here into the saddle of announcing, getting some facts straight. Ryan, any updates on the action?
Yeah, real interesting development. I mean, obviously it's a little anticlimactic, but as soon as the reviews were coming up for the run between Osbo and Yokoi, his team preempted the possible decision, came up here and launched a protest about the consistency of the speed and line of Osbo in that particular place, and saying that they had the actual onboard data to back it up. So they got the protest in on time, it seemed like, because it has to be in prior to the beginning of the next round. And now the technical staff is reviewing the data and taking a look at it. And, you know, we'll see if it changes the outcome as we're pulling up some of the other runs now to actually do a comparison. So a little bit of a, I guess, disappointment in terms of the flow of the show here, but the teams have the right to do this, and they did follow proper protocol, so we'll keep you guys posted on what's going on and on how this will come to a resolution.
And if you're the team, you know, like you said, flow of competition, if I'm RSR, I'm gonna fight for it. And that's kind of what I was talking about, Ryan. Is it quantifiable? I just don't think, me personally, my opinion, I don't think there's enough evidence that it was either a big mistake by Osbo, or if it was foul play to slow down enough when Yokoi hit him. He got aggressive from the start. Hats off to Yokoi, but he followed potentially too close to maybe 5 miles per hour slower Frederick Osbo. I not that I'm surprised about the decision of going with Yokoi. I'm just I probably would have sided with Frederick Osbo getting the victory in the finals. That's just my opinion, and obviously I'm entitled to it. They made their decision already, and it was unanimous, Yokoi, but that's kind of where I'm at as far as watching it unfold. I just don't think there's enough evidence to say that that Osbo slowed down dramatically. So a hush kind of falls over the crowd and online. As you can see, the track is cold, literally and figuratively, as it's freezing. Once that sun goes down, I'm telling you, it's going to drop probably 20 degrees as well. Last night we saw snow. Waking up, seeing Rocket Bunny K, seeing his car over here, it was covered with ice and snow this morning. A lot of the vehicles, including the Lamborghini Murcielago GTs over here, were covered with snow. So interesting setting here. A lot of us heading back tomorrow to the States, our whole staff. Thank you for watching and tuning in for the first ever Formula Drift Japan here at Okayama International Circuit, which go ahead and Google it, man. You'll see that we are up in the mountains, and you see that there's a lot of green around us. We are out in the middle of the forest, but this held Formula One races at one time until they moved it over to Fuji Speedway. So, I encourage you to check it out, and I encourage you to check out another round of Formula Drift Japan next year, included into the World Championship. Where that will be is TBD, but check formuladrift.com for all the updates on the 2015 Formula Drift schedule. So let's take a look once again, and that was a different angle right there, but then it comes in here. So Osbo initiates, e-brake by Osbo, throwing it in. So this was the
there's wheel spin and acceleration. That's what we didn't see in the previous race.
Right. I mean, that might be enough.
So hearing some of the talks, and you might be able to actually hear it.
He just didn't speed up like he typically, like he's supposed, like one would expect him to do.
All right, so we're taking a look at this replay of him between Akira and the that was against Hirajima out front.
Wasn't breaking,
right. Just off throttle with angle. The chase car is doing what he's supposed to do, which is make
All right, so. All right, so we're looking at another run. So this is the same run again. This is against Akira. So you see Frederick Osbo. So you're seeing Osbo. So what the judges are saying, just. Yeah. All right, so I think it comes down to consistency in the judge's eyes, and I think that's warrantable. I mean, I like that conversation between, okay, here's what Osbo's been doing previously, and what they're saying is when Yokoi and Osbo were doing battle, it seemed that Osbo was off throttle and really drifting without being on power, so not a line of smoke, not being on throttle, as opposed to, being on throttle when he went against Akira there. So we saw Osbo and Akira when Osbo initiated in the lead position. Okay, might have e-braked and then back on throttle. You saw the smoke kick up because he's creating wheel speed. Now against Yokoi is what the judges are saying, or I should say Lontaine is what I'm overhearing, is that when it was Osbo and Yokoi, they're talking about Osbo being off throttle or off RPMs to create wheel speed. Now let's see what kind of replay, what the, okay, so now this is the actual contact between Yokoi and Osbo. So on e-brake, throttle. So taking a look. So we are seeing that and really analyzing this. So the judges kind of debate, or their stance is, as I was saying, by comparison, Akira, when Osbo was out front, he was consistently on throttle, on RPMs, creating the wheel smoke. By comparison to when he was going against Yokoi, he seemed to be drifting in more ways than one, but not being on throttle, not creating the smoke. So Ryan, you're over there with RSR, their representative, and our judges. Where do we stand, Ryan?
It looks like all three judges, after reviewing not only the data that had been provided to them, but also previous runs with Osbo against competitors that were not Yokoi and Yokoi again, that they're going to stick with the result, and they were unanimous in that decision.
Okay.
So, it's one of those kind of things, for an event producer, sometimes the fairness that's been required and developed out of the U.S. series to take these things into interest for the actual competition sometimes can be, shitty for fans, as we wait through all these things. But, that's the balance that you have to strike if you want to make your teams happy and make sure that the complaints that they have are taken into consideration. So hopefully that wasn't too crazy of a delay here, but at least we got ourselves a decision, and now we'll see our final with Daigo Saito and Yokoi.
I think it's an interesting conversation and debate, for lack of a better term, but the judges analyzing, giving their verdicts and making it a better understanding of what the judges are looking for, because like I said, he was hit from the back. Did he slow down enough? And I was, when you were over there conversing, kind of walking the fans through what I overheard of Lontaine speaking, and Andy Yan and Daijiro Yoshihara was kind of digesting as well, and he's a driver, and he sided with consistency of the other judges, so it was unanimous once again.
It's interesting because it points out interesting discussions and conversations about implementation of telemetry and things like that. Telemetry can show you what your line is and how fast you're going through and be able to do a side-by-side comparison, but those two pieces of data can't necessarily tell you when you're on and off throttle, and if you're on and off throttle in different areas. That would actually require more data, but the stuff that was given to us was line and speed. So,
yep.
And if you saw those comparable runs, I could see why they sided in that favor. But I totally agree with the Team RSR that they had a case to bring forward, and they should. That's their right. They're fighting for points, they're fighting for championship, they're fighting for podium. So.
Yep. And with that verdict, Osbo does maintain that third spot, and the championship prior to that was already locked up. So the RSR team unfortunately does not advance on to the finals. Has to be handed a third place podium, or not be handed, but earned a third place finish, which is nothing to bat an eye at, as Saito and Yokoi go back to their spots. We are finally getting to the finals. Ryan, Saito and Yokoi, with Yokoi leading, being the number two qualifier.
Yep. And if people are interested in understanding about, you know, protests, we can definitely, you know, give you some more resources. Usually you have it protests that are not subjective, so an actual judging call cannot be protested. But when in the case of contact and applying fault, that's something that is not, does not fall into the category of subjectivity. If there is contact, fault has to be deemed, research has to be done, and then the judges can give their opinion on who won.
Hey.
Or who was at fault.
Who was at fault. Yep. All right, so here we go. The finals are set. Here we go. Japan and the world, thank you for watching. Here is your finals for the 2014 Formula Drift Asia final round. Masashi, oh, look at that, Yokoi, shots fired, son. Here we go, Daigo Saito throwing it in, chasing down Yokoi, coming into, oh, look at this, Daigo Saito getting out of shape, a big mistake by the ninja. Yokoi tapping the brakes, coming into the keyhole now, Saito. Woo! That JZX 100. And there goes Yokoi up the hill. Look at that. Saito right there next to him. Ryan, let's take a look at this again. Uncharacteristic of Saito today, as far as it seems. You know, made a mistake.
Yeah, let's take a look at that. That was definitely a noticeable mistake from Daigo Saito. Watch Yokoi kind of come into the middle lane right here. Daigo pulls back a little bit. We talked about that in the driver's meeting, about giving the lead driver the right of way in this particular course. But watch this. Daigo Saito comes up on the inside here, and he starts to lose angle. He has to get back on the throttle to stay in drift. And so that right there is a pretty big mistake that we haven't seen him make this weekend just yet, or at least in tandem today. He is obviously angered by that, gets back on the throttle right here, very, very close to Yokoi, who does a great job sweeping wide into that third outer zone. Door-to-door action here between these two drivers as Yokoi comes back around. Good, smooth transition up the hill. And then diving in once again is Daigo Saito. So, you know, you got to give an advantage there, I think, to Yokoi. Even though Saito had great proximity, it's a good battle so far, but we see that noticeable mistake by Saito. Now, Saito runs away with it on this run. It'll definitely be a hard call for the judges. What we're hearing is that some vehicles that are pitted up against Saito have at least a 1 second differential in the time that they make it through the course. So Saito has a lot of grip, a lot of power, but Yokoi is a formidable competitor as we break down and go into this last, possibly last run of our final event of the year here at Okayama.
Yeah, this could be it. This is for the win here at Okayama International Circuit. Frederick Osbo grabs third. Who's going to grab second? And then who's going to grab first? Daigo Saito throws it in, touches the dirt, already with that mistake. That's not what Saito needed in this instant, but Yokoi falls back. A big correction as Saito slingshots past that front clip, and Yokoi falls back. Man, Daigo Saito in the smoke machine. No magic needed. But man, I tell you what, that is a rocket ship. As he slingshotted, he touched the dirt, Ryan, out on that initiation. This should be interesting.
Well, here we go on the replay here. Saito coming down the front straight right here. Swings, drops a tire into initiation. On the inside, you can see Yokoi is with him to this point, but then Daigo goes way offline. He
way
is not
offline.
Deep. It allows him to pull ahead of Yokoi. Very, very big gap right here, probably 10 cars. Now, obviously, there will be some points for the gap, but he will lose some points for going not as deep as he should into that outer zone, which has been one of, if not the most critical parts of this course. So Daigo Saito goes wide at that last inside clip as well. He's all over the place here, even though he was able to pull away. So this will be interesting to see how the judges digest this. I mean, I would say on the first run, Daigo had that mistake. You give Yokoi an advantage there. Daigo comes back, has some good proximity. Maybe he takes a little bit away. The next run, Daigo makes an error on the lead, but pulls way out ahead of Yokoi. Yokoi going through the paces. So pretty interesting run here between these two competitors in our last run of the day.
All right, so Ryan, we know that Osbo grabbed third. Who gets the win? Saito had some major mistakes there. I have to think it's Yokoi. And, you know, I would say he's very deserving of it. Qualifying second overall, a good showing throughout the weekend, really good chase. You know, the only point of contention for me is, you know, the Osbo-Yokoi battle where, you know, I just don't think there was enough evidence. You know, that's a hard call, but you have to make a call. So, you know, hats off. I do not envy the judges. They have a very hard job. You know, Andy Yen, Ryan Lantane, and Dai Oshihara, they have a very difficult job to give a verdict. As as we are waiting to see our finals, let's bring our final three cars down here in front of the judges' stand. A round of applause from Saba-san. All right, so we are bringing our final three drivers down here. You could see Daigo Saito step outside of his vehicle. And as we said, Ryan, yesterday we got the news that Yokoi wants to petition to compete at Formula Drift US. I got to think that the other drivers are really paying attention right now, or they're going to be watching this if they're not watching it live here from Okayama.
Yeah, no doubt about it. He certainly made his name very well known amongst us here in terms of his skill as a driver, and obviously, you know, on the podium here. Sorry. Oh man.
Sorry, we just saw a photographer take a spill.
massive. I mean, it was massive, from a wall. Sorry about that.
He's okay. He's back up. I only laugh because he's okay.
But yeah, I mean, Yokoi has definitely made a name for himself this weekend. Obviously, you know, we know Daigo Saito as one of the preeminent drifters in the world, but Yokoi is certainly a talented driver in and of himself, and it would be great to see him next year in the World Championship.
Yeah, that'd be really sweet. And obviously, Saito, he's already been campaigning a World Championship, just not the official one that has that is going into you know, basically into the schedule next year. So the AA's Bo is currently putting on his tires and rims as they took them off, and the RSR GT86.
What are your impressions as we wait for Osbo to come down, and we have digested these two runs now and let it sit for a minute or two? What are your impressions between Yokoi and Saito?
I think Yokoi's got it. I think Yokoi won. Daigo Saito on the first battle made a big mistake. On the second battle, he hit the dirt for one. He failed to hit the outside clip. Yokoi, yes, had a big gap, and then the entirety of the course, and then just the nail in the coffin for me is he was way off that front clip. He's out front. He knows how to drive by comparison to you know, other runs. You know, it wasn't Daigo Saito-esque, for lack of a better term.
Well, there's Frederick Osbo. We'll see how his demeanor is after nearly making it to the finals against Yokoi.
Yeah, I mean, regardless, you know, Frederick Osbo, as he steps outside of his car, makes some noise for him.
He's all smiles.
Yeah, he's all smiles. I mean, he's still wrapped up the 2014 championship, so he's got to be feeling good. He's among some drivers that he really emulates, admires, as he shakes the hand of our fellow competitors. And there are three drivers as we will be going out. And we will announce third place, second place, and then first place. All right, so we are live here on Daily Motion. Let's announce our top three drivers. And we can see the three vehicles. Ready? All right. Waiting for our audio here to go live to Okayama International Circuit. We will have our podium ceremony. Unfortunately, that will not be on live stream or on Daily Motion. But again, this will all be aired later on. Thank you for joining us. As it's been a cold one here, as trying to expedite our announcement here. And waiting to see. All right. Check, check. Here we are. Thank you for joining us here at Okayama International Circuit. This is Jared Deanna, Ryan test. Sage. Saba-san, thank you so much. Arido-san, arigatou gozaimasu. Nabatero Taniguchi, arigatou gozaimasu. And, of course, Keiichi Tsuchiya, Drift King. Thank you so much. Thank you on behalf of all our judges. Let's announce our top three drivers finishing third here at the 2014 Formula Drift Japan Finale. In the RSR GT86, Frederick Osbo. Frederick Osbo grabs third place. Hi. And then grabbing second here at Okayama International Circuit for the final round of the 2014 Formula of Japan, you'll know who gets first place. Second place is Masashi Yokoi. Masashi Yokoi. No, sorry, no, no, Daigo Saito. Daigo Saito gets second place. Daigo Saito gets second place. No. Mistake. I've only made one before. Daigo Saito gets second. Unbelievable. Daigo Saito gets second place. Brian, that's only happened once before. So that means Masashi Yokoi, Ichiban, number one. Yokoi grabs first place. Oh. Woo!
Well,
Ryan, that's just how the day's kind of gone. We've had some interesting things unfold, but thank you so much. Unbelievable. I got excited.
Well, if you can't have fun watching this, you can't have fun at all.
Oh, I'm going to get lit up on the internet for that one. Thank you so much for joining us, Japan Okayama International Circuit, Frederick Osbo, Daigo Saito, and your winner, Yokoi Ichiban, here in Japan for the final round. Congratulations, Yokoi grabs second in the Formula Drift Asia Championship, and Frederick Osbo, your 2014 Formula Drift Asia Champion. Congratulations to Team RSR and their V8 GT86. We'll see you online, or we'll see you another time. Saba-san, thank you. Keiichi Tsuchiya, Menabo Rita, and Taniguchi. Hi. Arigatou
gozaimasu. Oh, man. Oh, man. I was worried about mispronouncing his name. Unbelievable. Oh, I'm so sorry.